Prolific comedian John Edward is such a regular visitor to our shores that he's pretty much an honorary Aussie. Mm.
Yeah.
Thank you for saying that. Yes. I would like to live here.
Yeah, really? Is that on the
would.
Cards one day?
I would not rule that out.
Is that right?
You could live right here on the panel if you want.
Right here. Just,
no, yeah. What's stopping
I'll take
you?
One of the beds.
What's stopping you? What's stopping you?
A daughter and a son.
And,
oh, yeah, that old chestnut.
You know, those, you know, my daughter's an actress and she's on a TV show in the States, so.
Is it a show we would know?
You guys are getting it here. It's called Better Things.
Oh, after that, yeah.
She's the little young one on the show.
I don't think I'm the target market somehow.
You're definitely not the target market.
Yeah, I have.
And did she always want to be an actress?
Yes, when she was 2 years old, there was a Gap commercial in the States, and she said, "Why am I not there?" And I said, "Why are you not where?" And she pointed. I said, "Playing with the kids?" And she said, "No. Why am I not there?" Like, on
God.
It. I was like, "Do you want to do that?" And she said, "Yeah."
Wow.
She's Amelia.
How old is she now?
She's 11.
11, so your wife's with her in there.
Yep.
And then your son's about to...
My son is with me, but he's looking at colleges. I have that...
Yeah.
Did you sort of worry about your daughter going into showbiz? Obviously,
no.
There's all the stuff that's come out now, but just, you know what it's like.
No, I'm a crazy control freak parent. You know, they talk about tiger moms.
Yeah.
So whatever the dad equivalent is, I'm a psychic tiger dad. So it's like I'm very, very clear about rules with social media. For me, it's about energy. So whether it's with my kids or me in general, I think it's really important to have healthy dialogues and communication with them about everything. So she's not allowed to be famous.
Right.
But the thing is,
she's not allowed to be. Yeah. She can be accomplished, but she can't be famous.
You've set that up from a very early age with your two children, haven't you?
I have.
Explain what you were.
So my thing is that they have to talk to each other, and they have to communicate with each other as if mommy, daddy, and grandparents aren't around.
Yeah.
Because I always say, like, nothing should come between a brother and a sister, not friends, not a husband and wife, not mommy or daddy, because in the end, you guys have a shared collective experience, something that only you guys can understand.
Yep.
So, like, I forced that to, I actually, you know, created that as, like, a rule. And they do that. Like, they talk to each other about what's happening in their lives.
Gotta ask, do they talk to dead people?
They are both extremely psychic.
Really?
They're very, very psychic. They could do readings. They do not.
Right.
It's not their thing. It's not their passion. I think if they wanted to, they really, really could. Like, they're really that. Like, if I have questions, I do go to them and say, "What do you feel about this?"
Right.
And they'll give me their actual intuition, and it's highly accurate. I think my wife would be apoplectic if either one of them decided that they wanted to do this, because I think one of us is enough. Yes, she feels one is enough.
If they could communicate with things that have left the mortal world, do you think they could find my radio career?
I could ask.
It's out there somewhere.
I could ask.
Is it, Joe? Is it?
Somewhere.
So everyone knows you as a medium, but they might be surprised at your life before you became a full-time psychic.
They might.
You were a... phlebotomist.
I was.
Not something I say lightly.
What is that?
So I was the person who walked into your hospital room with a basket and drew your blood. I was a venipuncturist, a phlebotomist. I was
a dance instructor?
I met my wife as a dance student. She was my teacher. And then I couldn't afford to take dance lessons and to stay part of her world because it was kind of expensive.
Right.
So I became a teacher so I could stay part of that world.
I was going to say you married her to get the free dance list.
Yeah. No, actually, it became really weird. I went to a different studio and I wound up competing against her. Yeah, it was really, really
strictly
funny.
Strictly ballroom.
So crazy.
That's the plot to Saturday Night Fever.
No, it's actually really, really crazy because we worked with another couple. So I danced with the wife and she danced with the husband and we literally wound up in competition against each other.
That sounds like swinging. I know it's not, but
it's
I'm
not,
just putting it out there.
It's swinging, but with music.
Yeah, okay.
Can I ask something? Sure. You just said you came into a hospital room to draw blood.
Yep.
At that stage of your life, did you get a feeling when you walked into the
bed? I did. So I was doing this work since I'm 15.
Yep.
And it was never going to be my career. Like, my career was going to be, like, a real career. Not that I'm doing is not a real career, but it's not what I was raised to... You know,
you're going to
have
a
real job.
Your dad was a police officer.
Yeah, it's like, you know, you have to get a job and you have to have, like, your 2 weeks vacation and all that kind of stuff. So my degree is actually in healthcare and public administration.
Mm.
I'm a few credits short of a master's degree in that field. But my mom died from cancer, so I kind of, like, couldn't handle being in school any longer.
Yeah.
But I completely forgot your question.
Well, no.
When you walked into the hospital,
nobody there knew I did this.
Yeah.
I kept it very kind of private.
Yeah.
But
Would you go?
No, but there were some very unique lessons that I learned in the hospital. And one of the things that I'll say to people is that nobody ever passes alone. So a lot of times people will set up schedules where they're constantly going to make sure that that person is not by themselves. Mm. And sometimes it's hard for somebody to actually leave when everybody's like right there, because we can't hold somebody back once they've crossed, but we can hold people back here when we don't make it about them. Mm. So for me, I got a chance to watch, like when people did pass, I would feel energies around the room in the hospital, and I would know that they weren't alone, that there were family members and friends coming for them. So that for me was a teaching moment as well.
Yeah. I think you did a reading with a good friend of the show, Simon Kennedy, who lost his mum during the September 11 attacks.
Okay.
And he's in comedy, he's a comedian, and he said that what you're, if you're selling connection, that's exactly what he needed. Went in as a skeptic, but did find peace after sitting with you.
And, I read him?
You read thousands of people.
You know, it's so funny. I don't really remember stuff. Like, they're borrowed thoughts. So it's like it kind of comes in, I experience it, and then I'm gone. And people say, oh, yeah, you said that. I'm like, I did? And they're like, yeah, you did. Mm. The only time I remember something is if I get taken out of it.
Do you, like, at parties, do people go, read me, do me?
No.
Okay.
Here's the thing at parties. My wife and I, I have a 90-minute rule. It takes 90 minutes before the alcohol that people consume make them brave enough to come up to me to ask me that question.
Do me.
So I know it's 90 minutes, so I make all my, like, hey, how are you? Thanks for having me in that 90 minutes. Wow.
And then you leave.
Can I ask a really stupid question?
Isn't that interesting?
Do you drink at all?
Nope.
No, right.
Nope, only spirits I deal with are
the ones up there.
And why?
So I was wondering how that would...
Why?
A couple
of reasons. One, my dad was an alcoholic, so it was not a positive influence in my family, so I have a thing with that. And then I'm a control freak, so I don't like giving up the control of something.
That alcohol did.
Yeah.
Is it like having a radio constantly in your... No, okay.
Nope. It is a choice to turn your energy on to do it. Mm-hmm. Think like singing.
Yeah.
If you're gonna sing, you don't just sing everywhere. You open yourself up, you warm up. My warm up is meditation and prayer. Then you do your singing, and then when you're done, a lot of people have to power down as well to make sure they maintain the instrument. So I kind of feel like I'm just a phone. I'm just like a piano. I try to stay as in tune as possible and bring through whatever it is that's gonna take place.
Mm. Has
what you do ever made you scared?
Living people scare me. So I've had some moments where reading for people, like I had one reading where somebody was in an abusive relationship and information came through about them being helped. And I was still reading out of my house at the time. So this was my like 7 o'clock appointment. At about 10:30 that night, someone came banging on my door and it was the husband of the person in the abusive relationship.
Mm.
That was slightly startling.
Mm.
That scared, see like living people scare me more than energy.
Okay. Right. Yeah. Now, you've got a new Facebook show.
I do.
Tell us.
So it's been a decade since I did anything on television, and they gave me the opportunity to do a 5-episode arc. So there's 5 shows. It's called The Psychic John Edward, and it's on their platform called Facebook Watch. So it's The Psychic John Edward, and they can find it on Facebook Watch.